See, good transplant outcomes depend on good patient selection and the immunologic background of transplant. As I told you right at the beginning, I started doing CDC cross-match in early transplants, and we had to send for serologic samples to Mumbai and get the report after about 2 weeks before we could consider doing transplants. From that time to getting serologic typing in our hospital, then now the molecular typing, and having somebody like Dr. Amit Jojera, who's a nephrologist and has worked hard to get the molecular typing and all going very well. Now request Amit to talk about pre-transplant immunologic work. Amit, please go ahead. I can see your slide. So
Yes,
please
sir.
go
Yes,
ahead
sir.
with it.
Good evening, everyone, and I will be talking about the pre-transplant immunologic workup. So, what is the fundamental goal of immunologic workup pre-transplant? The fundamental goal of the testing is to provide a reliable measure of the immunologic risk of transplant recipient in context of their potential donor. And the two essential parts of this immunologic workup are the HLA typing of the patient and the donor, and the testing of the recipient for the anti-HLA as well as non-HLA antibodies. And in the recent years, there has been significant advances in the techniques for the HLA typing, as well as there has been improved sensitivity and specificity of the detection methods for the HLA antigen antibodies against the HLA as well as non-HLA antigens. And because of the continuous evolution of these methods, the nature of these measurements have also changed over the period of time. We're looking into these methods. I will briefly go through this. The first part of this is the HLA typing. And I will very briefly go through the various methods which are used, and then moving on to our own experience here in our immunology lab. The first step in all the methods is common, which is the isolation of the genomic DNA from the patient and the donor samples. And then this isolation is followed by the locus specific amplification. Here is the PCR. Till this step, all the methods are common. And from there here onwards, all the methods, they become different. In sequence specific primer or the SSP method, there are two ways you can do the HLA typing here. Either by you can use gel electrophoresis, which is gel-based detection, or one can do melting curve detection, which is done by real-time PCR instrument. Both these methods, they are considered low-resolution methods. The other one is the sequence-specific oligonucleotide hybridization, or the SSO method. This is considered intermediate resolution method. And in this, the dot plot, there are four various techniques like dot plot, blot dot, microarray, and Luminex reverse SSO. And in this, the Luminex reverse SSO is by far the most commonly used method in most of the immunology labs around the world. And the other one is the high resolution HLA typing or the sequence based typing, which can be done either by Sanger sequencing or by next generation sequencing. When we compare this Luminex SSO with NGS typing, the concordance is usually around 97 to 98%. Both these methods, they give 6 to 8 digit HLA typing. However, the Luminex, being the intermediate resolution, it has a concordance rate of around 97 to 98% with high resolution typing. And most of the discrepancies, they usually arise in class 2 loci, especially in HLA DQ and DP typing. Moving on to the antibody screening and identification methods, we can broadly classify them into two categories. The first is the antigen non-specific category. The other one is the antigen specific category. In the antigen non-specific category, these are the cell-based assays, which is the CDC cross-match or the microlymphocytotoxicity cross-match, along with its various modifications to enhance its sensitivity, like extended incubation or AHG augmentation, or we use DTT to eliminate the effect of the IgM antibodies. And the other is the flow cross-match. The antigen specific methods, they include ELISA testing for both HLA antibodies as well as non-HLA antibodies. We have bead-based assays on flow cytometer, that is flow PRA, and then we have multiplex suspension assays, which are done on Luminate platform. And the list of these assays has been growing in recent years. It started with single antigen bead testing as well as DSS screening, along with PRA testing. Now we have tests for tests like LYSAT cross-match, C1Q DSA, C3D DSA. Testing for MICA antibody testing, and now recently even non-HLA antibody testing kits have been introduced in US for on Luminex platform, and soon they will be available all around the globe. Before going further, I will just like to clarify the differences between the three most commonly ordered tests on the Luminex based platform and the commonly most commonly used tests. These are the first one is the Luminex screen assay. The other is the PRA assay, which is also known as the multiple antigen beads. And the third one is the single antigen assay. The basic difference here is the composition, where it is antigen composition per bead. Here we can clearly see in Luminex screen, each bead will have a complete class 1 or 2 phenotype, pooled class 1 or 2 phenotypes of 3 to 5 individuals. So here the antigen density per bead is low and it gives only positive and negative result, whether the patient has class 1 antibodies or class 2 antibodies. It will not show quantification or any semi-quantitative analysis will not be given. When we look at the PRA assay or which is called multi-antigen beads, in this each bead will have a complete class 1 or class 2 phenotype of one individual. So one bead will have complete phenotype of one particular individual, and so it will have multiple beads here, and so it will have phenotypes of multiple individuals. Here the antigen density is intermediate, and it gives, in this particular assay we get the MFIs, but we cannot pinpoint against which antigen the antibodies are reacting. I will show you in the next slide again. And as we all know, in the single antigen, each bead will have only one antigen coated on its surface. And so it is highly specific method. The antigen density is high and specific as well as sensitive. The single antigen is specific as well as sensitive. And even single antigen assay gives us a calculated PRA value. We'll just look at the machine generated report of a PRA assay here. If we look at the individual beads here, for example, let us take the first bead, that is the bead number 106 here, for example. And in here we can clearly see the MFI is given, it's 8600, it's positive here. And here is the list of antigens, it's the complete class 1 phenotype of an individual. This is class 1 report, and this complete class 1 phenotype of an individual is present on this bead. So we know that the antibody is reacting against this bead, but we cannot pinpoint against which antigen the antibody has reacted. So we cannot specify against which particular antigen the reaction has taken place. And based on the percentage of the beads against which the antibody has reacted, it will give us the percentage PRA value. Moving on to the single antigen bead based assay, we can clearly see here that each bead has only one antigen coated on its surface. And so if the MFIs will be there, it will be specifically for that particular antigen only. And hence we can pinpoint against which antigen the bead has reacted. Our protocol for pre-transplant workup at Muljibai MPUH, we do HLA typing of all the patients and donors by Luminex reverse SSO method, that is an intermediate resolution technique. We do HLA typing for loci A, B, C, DRB1, DQB1, and DQA1. For antibody detection, we do CDC crossmatch along with AHG augmentation, as well as we also use DTT in every crossmatch. We do flow cross match for every patient and single antibody testing in every patient. Since we started the immunology lab and started doing all the three modalities of antibody detection together, we have done 150 transplants here, and we have done the screening for these 150 patients. Out of these, 120 were male patients and 30 were female patients. The age group wide distribution, if we see, most of the patients were there in the highest number of patients were in the fourth decade, that is 31 to 40. Followed by the third decade, that is 21 to 30, and then we have the patient in 41 to 50 age group. The main age was 35.7 years, the youngest being 11 years, and the oldest recipient was 62 years in this particular data. When we look at the HLA loci mismatch, we divided our data into four groups. First was up to 3 loci mismatch, the second group was 4 to 6 loci mismatch, the third was 7 to 9 loci mismatch. And finally, 10 to 12 loci mismatch. And this is the number of the column. The second column is the number of the patients in each with number of the mismatches. And the third is we try to correlate with the biopsy proven rejection episodes in the early post-transplant period, that is the first 6 months after the transplant. This particular data is irrespective of the single antibody status. And here we could not find a significant correlation with the loci mismatch and the percentage of the rejections. Patient showing rejection. However, when we analyze specifically the patient who were single antibody negative, here we could see that with increase in the loci mismatch, we could clearly see the increase in the percentage of the patients showing biopsy proven rejection in the early post transplant period. You can clearly see as the mismatch have increased, the percentage have also gone up. There were no case when the mismatch was 3 or less than 3. 4.9% of the patient, that is approximately 5% when the mismatch was 4 to 6 loci. And as the mismatch goes higher, the percentage of the patient showing rejection also starts going higher. Looking at our results from the single antibody testing, a total of 150 patients were done. And amongst out of 150 patients, what we saw was that 79 were negative, totally negative for single antibody testing, in single antibody testing, and 71 patients, they had positivity in single antibody testing. Amongst the 71 positive patients, 15 had only class 1 antibodies, 32 had only class 2 antibodies, and 24 patients, they had both class 1 and 2 antibodies. Further looking into this single antibody positive patients, if we divide them in according to the donor specificity, the 56 patients out of 71, they had non-donor specific antibodies, and 15 patients, they had donor specific antibodies. In the donor specific group, again, out of 15, 2 had only class 1 antibodies, 10 had only class 2 antibodies, and there were 3 patients who had both class 1 and 2 antibodies. And when we look at the non-donor specific group, again, out of 56, 14 patients had only class 1 antibodies, 27 had class 2 antibodies, and 15 patients had both class 1 and 2 antibodies. If we look at the profile of the antibodies, we will see that in class 1, the highest number of antibodies were against the HLA-B locus, followed by HLA-A locus, and then HLA-C locus. And in class 2, the highest number of antibodies were highest number of patients, they had antibodies against DQ locus, followed by DRB1 locus. Then we have DP locus, that is 11 patients. And finally, 6 patients, they had antibodies against the one of the antigens of the HLA DRB345 loci. Next, we'll look at the, try to correlate with the single antigen positivity with the biopsy proven rejections, acute rejections in the early post-transplant period. We divided the data into 3 groups. First was the single antigen negative group, the second group was the single antigen positive group, and the third was single antigen positive, but they were non-donor specific. However, the third group was donor specific antibodies. And what we saw was that in the first two groups, that is the single antibody negative and non-donor specific group, there was not much difference in the percentage of the patients showing biopsy proven rejection. Whereas when we compared these two with the donor specific group, there was increase in the percentage. We can see from 8-9% to around 20% of the patients showing biopsy proven acute rejections. We tried to look whether the class of these antibodies had any effect on this or not. And here what we saw was that when the patients had both class 1 and 2 antibodies, there they had the more percentage of the patients, they had biopsy proven acute rejections. This can be seen both in single antigen, the non-donor specific as well as donor specific groups. Next, we look at the correlation between the single antigen beat positivity and sensitization history. And what we saw was that when the MFIs were less than 2,500, around 50% of the patients were shown to have sensitization history. Whereas when the antibody titers were on the higher side, almost all the patients, they had sensitization history. Next, we tried to correlate the flow cross-match positivity with the single antigen beat testing. And here we had divided our data into 3 groups, that is T cell positive, B cell positive, and combined T and B cell positive. We can see that in T cell positive, we had 5 patients who had only T cell positive, 4 patients had B cell positive flow cross match, and 3 patients who had both T and B cell positivity. Amongst the T cell positive 5 patients, 1 patient had single antigen, only class 1 antibodies, and there were 4 patients who had both class 1 and 2 antibodies. And all these cases, the antibodies were donor specific. In B cell positive group, out of 4 patients, 3 patients, they had class 2 antibodies, and there was 1 patient who had neither class 1 or class 2 antibody. That is, he was single antibody negative. He was also CDC negative. And we know that B cells can sometimes express Fc receptors. They express Fc receptors on the surface, and the anti-IgG, which is used in this flow cross match, it can bind non-specifically to these Fc receptors and produce false B cell positivity in flow cross match. And the third group, that is both T and B cell positive, there were 3 patients, and all the 3 of them, they had both class 1 and 2 antibodies. and they were donor specific. So except the one patient who had isolated BSL positivity and no SAB negative, all the 11, rest of the 11 patients, they were rejected during the immunologic workup. Finally, we looked at the correlation between all the three assays, that is CDC, flow, and single antigen testing. And here we had the data, all of the patients which analyzed, that is 161 patients, 150 were transplanted, and 11, they were rejected in this. And we see what we saw was that there were 70, we had divided into different groups. The first group, as you can see on the top, is the one where negative with all the three methodologies, that is CDC, flow, and single antibody testing. These were the 78 patients. The other extreme, we look at the lower bottom here, is the two patients who are positive with all the three methodologies, that is CDC positivity, flow positivity, as well as single antigen positivity. The point which is to be seen here is that in this case, the MFIs of the donor-specific antibodies were more than 10,000 here. Whereas the other four scenarios, we see that when the MFIs of the donor-specific antibodies, they were less than 10,000. In these cases, CDC was negative. However, these antibodies were picked up by the flow cross-match. So that is where it highlights the role of a flow cross-match as well. We had another 71 patients here, where we had CDC negative as well as flow negative. And the MFIs of the donor-specific antibodies, they were less than 5,000, except for the HLA-DQ and DP loci. The HLA-DQ and DP loci, even with higher MFIs, they're not picked up on flow cross-match because the density of these antigen on B cell is on the lower side. So to end, I will try, because of time constraint, I try to be as brief as possible in this presentation. And so in the end, to conclude, the CDC testing must be supplemented with other more sensitive antibody detection methods in pre-transplant immunologic evaluation. False B-cell positivity can be observed in flow cross-match, so flow cross-match must be interpreted in combination with other assays. In our data, we saw that anti-HLA-DRB345 loci antibody as well as DP antibodies accounted for around 5 to 10% of the single antibody positivity. Hence, HLA typing of these loci should also be included in pre-transplant workup. And the spectrum of antibody testing should be expanded to include MICA testing for non-HLA antibodies, as well as C1q DSA, especially if cost is also an issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amit, for this excellent presentation. And I would recommend every single PG from both nephrology and urology to go and meet Amit sometime when he is a bit more free and understand this in relation to the well-being of your patients. That is my suggestion. Amit, thank you very much for making it simple.